Please stand for the reading of the Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 13th chapter. Jesus said, "In those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then you will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and will gather his elect from the four winds, from the four ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree you learn its lesson. As soon as its branches become tender and put forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be aware. Keep alert. For you do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his works, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cock crow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. So, probably no surprise, me being a Brit, I love Monty Python. And I've raised my kids to love Monty Python too. One of my favourite movies, well, there aren't a whole bunch to choose from, but one of my favourites is Holy Grail. And there's a wonderful scene in Monty Python, The Holy Grail, when God speaks to King Arthur and his knights. And God says, "Arthur," you know, because God always sounds like that. "Arthur, Arthur, King of the Britons." And Arthur and all his knights fall flat on their face. "Oh, don't grovel," says God. "Get up, get up. If there's one thing I can't stand, it's people groveling." So Arthur and all the rest of the men, they stand. And Arthur says, "Sorry." And God says, "And don't apologize. Every time I try to talk to someone, it's sorry for this and forgive me for that. And I'm not worthy. And what are you doing now? I'm averting my eyes, Lord." "Well, don't. I really hate it. Where did all this get started? It's like those miserable psalms. They're so depressing. Now knock it off." "Yes, Lord, I'm knocking it off." And on the scene goes. I don't know when we got into that mode. "What are you doing now? I'm averting my eyes." "Well, don't. What are you doing? I'm groveling." "Well, get up." Every time I try to speak to someone. When did we get into that mode? I think it came in the Middle Ages when Christianity got incredibly depressing. It was a time when things were quite depressing, so psychologically I understand it. And I kind of know what the church was up to at that time, and it all came together into quite a depressing sort of sackcloth and ashes mentality. But if you want to see how the relationship between God and God's people really is meant to be, then look at the Old Testament. And we see a glimpse of that in the reading from Isaiah today. Now, I know the readings for the first Sunday in Advent are not exactly the most exciting readings ever anywhere. We're all ready for Christmas, and what we have is God being mad to us because we're like filthy cloth. And then we get to the Gospel, and the heavens are falling. Literally, the heavens are falling. What a way to start Advent. What a way to start the preparation for Christmas. With earthquakes and fire and miserable people. Although Cecil B. DeMille was the director that said, start with earthquakes and fire and then build up to a climax. And that's how we start Advent. But look closely at the Isaiah text. In fact, any time you see Isaiah, look closely. He is an awesome prophet. What we're seeing here, or what we're hearing here, we're eavesdropping. We're listening in on a conversation between a prophet and God. And we often just assume, I think, incorrectly, that prophets are people who talk to us on behalf of God. That's kind of a basic job description, isn't it? It's like number one in the job description of a prophet. The ability to talk to people on behalf of God. Number two is the ability to die when the people don't like what they hear, for they will kill you. After that, there is no number three on the job description. You understand why. But prophets often talk to God on behalf of the people. And we get to listen in on that conversation. And it's a fascinating conversation. As Isaiah struggles with God, as Isaiah wrestles with God. You know, says Isaiah, it's no wonder the people have gone to hell, because you, Lord, haven't interacted with them for a while. You've kind of withdrawn from them, and they forgot who you were, and they've turned to their own devices. Isn't that incredible? That a prophet stands before the face of God and says, yeah, those people are miserable so-and-sos. And it's because you've left them alone. So Isaiah's text is talking about judgment. But then it moves from judgment to comfort. You've hidden your face from us. Yeah, you've delivered us into the hands of our iniquity. But, or in the words of the NRSV, yet, O Lord, you are our Father. And then there's that wonderful image of you are our Father and you mold us like the potter molds clay into something with shape and structure and care and purpose, so that at the end, the ugly lump of clay becomes something wondrous and useful and loved. Because, and here comes Isaiah's zinger right at the end, because we are your people. We belong to you. In the gospel text this morning, we start off with judgment, just as we did in the Isaiah text. Except at the end, it's not judgment and comfort, it's judgment and promise. Keep awake, for he's coming. Now, you can take that as a threat. Wait till your father gets home. He'll see to you. And judging by the looks on the faces, that's a phrase you're familiar with, having heard it or having spoken it. But to me, it sounds more like a promise. Stay awake, for he's coming. Stay awake, for he's coming, and you are his people. Judgment and comfort. Judgment and promise. As we struggle with God. And we're in good company. Isaiah did, Abraham, Oh, did Abraham's trouble with God. Remember the story of Sodom? And I don't mean the violent, dirty bits at the end. I mean, when Abraham hears that God is going to destroy Sodom, and Abraham starts to haggle. I'm sure there's a theological way of saying that. There's probably a long, multi-syllabic Greek or Hebrew phrase for that, but let's be honest, he haggles with God. God says, Abraham, would you destroy Sodom if there were a couple of hundred righteous people in it? You know, would you destroy those righteous for the sake of the unrighteous? No, says God. Okay. If there's a whole bunch of righteous people, I won't destroy Sodom. God, if there were only 100 righteous people, though, you still wouldn't destroy Sodom with 100 righteous people in it. No, says God, I wouldn't. And Abraham haggles him down to 10. I want to take Abraham with me the next time I buy a car. Or negotiate a stipend contract. Or put in a bid for a house. I want Abraham with me. Never mind burying St. Joseph upside down in the yard. I'm going to bury Abraham. Well, Lord, how about 10? If there's 10 righteous people in Sodom, you wouldn't destroy Sodom and thereby destroy 10 righteous, would you? Says God. If there's 10 righteous people in Sodom, I won't destroy it. And what about Jacob, who, and this is too long a story to tell in a mere 45-minute sermon, but what about Jacob when he's conned his brother out of his birthright, tried to get hitched to Rachel, entered into a bad bargain with Rachel's father, and then hits the road, Jack, and doesn't come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Off under the highway goes Jacob with Rachel and a whole bunch of livestock. And God comes after him. And Jacob Ford, the angel, comes to Abraham, and Abraham physically wrestles, good old style Greek wrestling, wrestles with the angel all night. And it isn't until the angel dislocates Jacob's hip that Jacob finally says, I give in. And at that point, Jacob is given a new name, Israel. And Israel means the one who wrestles, struggles, strives with God. There's a reason I went down that rabbit hole. Honestly, there is. I think we have fooled ourselves as people of God into thinking that the person we struggle with is the devil. As the liturgy puts it, the devil and all his empty promises. And it comes up in some baptismal rites. I remember the one from my childhood. It's so poetic. Where the whole congregation says to the newly baptized, fight valiantly under the banner of Christ against sin, the world, and the devil, and continue his faithful soldier and servant to the end of your days. I mean, that was just astoundingly beautiful, and I have goosebumps just saying it out loud. You know what I've learned, perhaps, arguably most profoundly, as I've struggled with God? Is that the people of God spend more time struggling with God than they do with the devil. We are more disbelieving of God's promises to us than we are of the wiles of the devil. We can sometimes see where the devil is and avoid him. But God, we're in such a close relationship with him that we cannot even believe that he loves us, knowing how miserable we are. Cannot believe that he created us to be something awesome, when in the mirror we see only our own reflection. Can't believe that God loves that person two rows down and four people over to the left because we can't stand them. How can God love them? Well, we struggle against God's promises. As we stop at the light and see the person begging, we cannot believe that God loves that person. And the person who keeps us awake every night because we're so annoyed with what they do, or what they teach, or how they comport themselves, we cannot imagine that God would love even them. But God does. We struggle more against God, more with God, than we ever come to realize. But God understands. Look at the Old Testament. Yes, there are many people in the Old Testament who rebel against God, who are in open rebellion. This is a rebellious and a troublesome house. Those people end up dead, either literally or spiritually. God cannot stand rebellion. But those who wrestle with God in faith, they seem to thrive because of their faith. Because their struggle is righteous. So that even the psalmist who curses God and shakes a fist at God for the suffering that they and their loved ones are enduring are recognized as having faith because they are speaking to someone, acknowledging God's power and authority. And even as they curse, they are speaking to the heart of God. So, judgment and comfort, judgment and promise, a faithful and exciting, striving, wrestling with God, of talking with God, and bartering with God, and crying to God in pain, and screaming at God in anger, and pleading with God in confusion, makes us Israel, God's people, the ones who strive with Him. I'm ending on the most hopeful words that I can see in the scriptural text today. The remembrance of who we are, and the remembrance of who God is. The remembrance of the promise and the comfort. The remembrance of the right orientation between people and Creator. The remembrance of who it is that sits watchfully awake and in anticipation of the coming of the Christ child. We, God, are your people. Amen.